the word productivity often productivity is the output of the company or organization, what we are able to get out. And morale, most of you might not have heard. Morale is not moral. Moral, you would have heard about that word, but morale is something different. Morale is about exactly, if you want the word, we call use synonym is zeal. It is like enthusiasm. Zeal, Z-E-A-L, zeal. That means how enthusiastic you are, how motivated, how jumpy you are. That is what morale is. So usually in an organization, in a workplace, what do we do? What do we do with morale? Is morale helps the person to feel happy and pushed towards the job. It is like motivation from within. It makes you do more, feeling energy, anxiety. That is what the morale is. A place where morale is high, you can see that people will be happy and willing to take up the task. So you can say this is like a vicious circle. Productivity gives a boost morale, and in turn, morale gives more productivity, and it goes like a circle. So in short, we can say that happy employees are productive employees. How this works? When employee morale is high, the job satisfaction is a little high. You feel that you are well. Overall well-being will be feeling good. You are physically and mentally fit and well, feeling good about that. If you feel good about yourself, you are feeling good about whatever you are doing and the job. Same way, if you are feeling good about your job, then it makes you feel good about yourself. It goes again in the circle. So if you want to do something more, you are working harder for that to accomplish. And the same way, emotional investment becomes higher. You are bonded with your job. You get affiliated towards your job, workplace, and the people around you in the workplace. You start liking them. You make some emotional relationships with them, friendly. You become more friendly. So morale works in so many dynamics. So it improves the productivity by itself. And what is the relatedness between the productivity and morale? It is not always that a happy employee will produce more. It is not like that. You have to see the relativity of morale and productivity. First, let us see the lowest part, where the morale is low, productivity is also low, this box. When both of morale and productivity is low, this is a highly unidealistic situation where the people are lacking motivation, and because of that, there is no harmony in the workplace. People doesn't feel the belongingness and don't bond with others, and this becomes an unideal situation in the workplace. And if the morale is very low, but productivity is high, this box. Productivity is high always in the organization, but the people are not talking to each other, or the morale is very, all of them are dull, they are forced to do the work. Then, again, this is not an ideal situation, because why the productivity is high, but the morale is low, since the morale is low, it shows that people are afraid of punishment. They do the work not because of feeling satisfied or feeling happy. They do that because somebody might punish them if they don't do. This is a classic example of negative motivation. What is wrong in this? What is, why when high productivity is there, why we should be worried about? Because this cannot be prolonged. This is a short-term situation. People cannot work with the fear for a long time. It will evolve into a revolution. So this won't happen. We have a lot of historical examples of where high productivity and low morale cannot go hand in hand for a long time. And the third situation is where the morale is very high, but the productivity is not relevant to that. It is not proportional to the morale. Low productivity, but morale is high. That means people are very happy. They don't have any work or commitment. They are not answerable or accountable. They don't have that much of responsibility to share it. So they feel very happy, satisfied, but the productivity is very low. So which is the ideal situation? Both of them are balanced, high morale and high productivity. This is the ideal situation where people do the work happily, productivity is good, high, and it becomes a circle. It gives more morale, it gives more productivity, and so on so. So this is the productivity and morale relationships. So we come to the next part of that. How morale can help in productivity? But what is the real outcome of this morale? You feel motivated. Motivation is a very important chapter. Kindly all of you mark it. You will certainly, you will get questions in part A as well as part B in motivation. There are a lot of theories of motivation. We will see that. First, let us understand what is motivation. Motivation is a drive which pushes you towards doing something. The best example or the basic example of motivation, you know, everybody feels that. What is that? Hunger. Without that motivation, if you are not going to feel hungry 3 times or 2 times a day, you are not going to get up from your couch, or you are not forced or driving to do something. Am I right? You will not feel like doing anything if you are not going to feel hungry or thirsty. So that is a built-in motivation for all the living things, so that we will be producing something. So motivation is a drive that keeps people active. There are two ways of motivation you have to understand before getting into theories. One is extrinsic motivation, another one is intrinsic motivation. As the name suggests, extrinsic motivation is nothing but where the motivation comes from external factors. Like if you do this work, you will get a reward, or you will get incentive, you will get a perk, you will get promotion. All these things are extrinsic motivation. So you are like you are bought, you are given with something to make you motivated, to make you do something. But intrinsic motivation is the pleasure you achieve by doing something internally. You do that because you are willing to do that, inspired to do that, you are feeling pleasure to do that. So that is intrinsic motivation, which comes from within. If this can be because of the way you work, or the value you are believing in, or how you are grown up, all these essentially these gives the things for, like why you want to do the motivation. So here is the word where it comes from. It is like desires, want or drives of the individuals, and as it says, it's stimulating people to actions. And adequately motivated employees perform more productively. They feel more engaged towards the work. And without this motivation, maybe see, for example, to make this clear, I'll tell you how we feel now in this era, right? After this pandemic, we are not face to face facing and taking the class as usual. I can feel that I'm less motivated as I'm not looking at the facial expressions of the students, which is a real motivating factor for a teacher, right? So when it is not adequately motivated, the performance or productivity is tend to be a little less. This investment in the job is really less. So this is how motivation works essentially in any organization. And another one thing you have to understand is that happy employees are not essentially motivated employees. Understand this particularly. Motivation and happiness are not synonymous in the workplace. You have to understand the nuances between these two. A motivated employee may not be happy sometimes because he is not able to finish the work at time. The same way, happy employees may not be motivated up to the mark because they are already feeling satisfied and contented, so they may not be motivated. So happiness index is not essentially equivalent to the motivation index. Any manager should understand this. Yes.
Oh, cheese ho gaya.
Cheese ho gaya.
Yes. Anybody is talking to me? Any doubts? Okay. Right. So we come to the motivation theories. There are so many motivation theories which we take up from two branches of studies, like sociology. And another one is psychology. Most of these theories are contributed from these two branches. we take up which are matching to the workplace, and we use those theories for motivation to understand our organizational behavior. So in this, we take up a lot of theories. Out of that, I have listed out some few important theories. And again, for exam point of view, the motivation theories are important questions. So you may be asked to write about motivation theories 1 or 2, or any particular theory named and asked to define. So mark it as an important question. So we see one by one the motivation theories. The first one is Maslow's need hierarchy theory. This is the basic theory. Why I took it first is, if you are able to understand this theory, it will be very easy for you to go on and understand the other theories well. So what is Maslow's theory say? This theory is contributed by Abraham Maslow, and need hierarchy is the name of the theory. Need hierarchy, by the name itself, I think you will be able to understand hierarchy of needs. What do you need first? What do you need second? Excuse me, I have some disturbance. I will finish. I'll just take care of that and come back. Sorry for that. Are you able to see the PPT?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, right. So need hierarchy, as the name suggests, hierarchy of needs. Every man has needs. If you are able to satisfy that, you will be able to move on to the next need, right? So he has given a ladder of needs where one person will satisfy that and go on further for other needs. So I have given you both the words and the iconic examples of that. Say the first one is physiological. Like, what do you need to live, exist? You need food and a shelter to take care of your physique. So that is physiological needs. If you are not able to satisfy that need, if you are feeling hungry for 3 days, you will not be able to see anything else other than food. You need water and food and a place to sleep. Sleep and hunger you cannot forego. That is the basic needs you have to satisfy. So that comes as the first need in the hierarchy. The second one, if you are able to get food and a shelter to stay, you need a secured feeling. You need a security that you will have this the next day also. You what do? You tend to search for a job to keep up these things that you will continuously get. So that would be your second need. If you are able to fulfill that need also, you cannot live happily in your home where you can get food and shelter and continuously you are getting that. We are social animals after all. So what do we seek? We seek for some friendship. We seek for some people to mingle with. We want to have love. We want to give love. So we go for the social. And this is what do you say? This generation is the you are in the highest pedestal now in the social networking and being socializing. You have a new definition of socializing which we don't. So that would be the third need. You need to be social. If that is also fulfilled, what happens? You go on searching for some self-esteem. It is like you are searching for control. You want to have power. We have pet dogs, we have children, and we need to control them. Why is that? It satisfies the ego, it satisfies the self-esteem that I own a home, I own a pet. I have some people who I can control with. This extends to the workplace also. When you are fulfilling the social and you are in a team, you would like to become a team leader, you would like to become a manager in your mid-age. Why? You want to control, you want to have the taste of power. That is self-esteem. You are fulfilling your ego dreams. Then what happens? Now you have everything, right? You have 3 times food, very good food. You have a big home. You have a very good social standpoint. You have a good family. You have relations. You have friends. You have party every weekend, everything. And you are having a high self-esteem. You are powerful, influential. there are hundreds of people who listens to you, right? Everything you have, are you satisfied with that? No. As per Maslow and as per the psychological behavior of people, people cannot feel satisfied even with that thinking everything you have. You need to self-actualize. Self-actualization is what is the highest potentiality, capability I have. I want to explore that. What can I do at the best? What is the maximum possibility of myself? If you are able to ask this question and go seek for that, that is self-actualization, right? So this is a generalized theory, but there are exceptions that you cannot say every one of us go through these steps. Every one of us feels the motivation to go through this hierarchy of needs. No, there are exceptions. Like, see, for example, many of us would not have felt the need of physiological needs. Like, always we would have had food properly. So we may not have felt the need of hunger, need of food, because we have not felt hunger, right? Or security. In that case, if you have got placement after finishing your college, you may not have felt the need of having security. So maybe we have landed ourselves in the third step directly. So we have foregone the two steps, social needs. I have landed in the social need. So I don't know what is those two needs. So I will be only going up the ladder, social, self-esteem and self-actualization. Same way, it is not necessary that every one of us has to go through all the five steps. For example, many of us can stop with self-esteem. You think that this is enough in the life, I have everything. So you may stay in the seat of power for a long time. You don't want to get away from the power and search for what is really you are good at. Right? It takes a lot of guts to go through that. That's why if you see on the top of self-actualization, I have given the world's best example of self-actualization, who has renounced his power because he was born as a prince. So he has landed exactly in the fourth step actually. He got an early marriage, Buddha. So immediately he was able to identify that all his needs are fulfilled and he started searching for his self-actualization. There are people who has skipped some steps, who has started from physiological and right away all the four steps crossed and went to self-actualization. There are so many examples. As an assignment, what you can do, you can think about placing people in these four or five steps. You can write names where this particular popular person is or where you are, right? So that will help you understand the theory. I will give a pass here because this is a basic theory which I want all of you to understand clearly so that we can move on to other theories. If you have doubts here itself, I need to stop because other theories will be tough if you are not able to understand this. Any doubts in Maslow's theory? Any doubts? Shall we move on to the next theory?
Yes, ma'am.
Right. So why I am stressing up is because if you have any doubts here itself, it is better we have to wait and do the next thing, right? Okay, we go to the next one theory. I feel myself that I am a little bit faster today, but we can't help it because I think that we have to finish up better so many things. So if you have any doubts, please then and there itself you can ask today, okay? Right. So the next one is ERG theory. This is existence, relatedness and growth. You can see that this theory is a compact version of Maslow's theory, right? Instead of five steps, this is only three steps. That physical, that first two steps is merged into existence, social is relatedness and the growth is the last one, self-actualization, right? So this is like a compact version. So exactly those needs are put in three different names, which is existence is what are the needs you need to exist, just physical and material needs. Relatedness is interaction, social interactions, because you need to grow. If you are not having social interactions, your growth is stagnated. You cannot grow up without people around you, so relatedness. And growth is a output of this existence relatedness. You are growing inside, not only outside. You are able to mature inside. Your self-esteem is growing. As a result, you seek your self-actualization. So that is the ERG theory, right? We go to the next one, McClelland theory. This McClelland theory says that any person has need of three things: need of power, need of affiliation, need of achievement. Once again, you can see that this power is self-esteem, affiliation is social, and achievement is self-actualization. So McClelland theory, essentially what it says, it skips the first two steps and takes up the three, and it says that any person can have different kinds of motivation. It is not that everyone has to have all the three. If one has the power, he may then seek for the affiliation, or if one has the affiliation, then he may seek for the power. So it is not essentially it has to go through any steps or ladder. Any person can seek these three at any point of time after fulfilling any one of these need. Okay, so this is McClelland's theory. The next one is two factor theory. This is a little bit different from that. Two factor theory is XY, we say that it is hygiene and motivation factors. These are two different kind of motivation. One is like positive motivation, another one is negative motivation. See, these hygiene factors are people having some factors in the workplace, it causes the opposite of the motivation. Say for example, the supervision quality, the supervisor is biased, he is partial to one person to the other. So what happens? People feel demotivated. And rate of pay, the same way, if you are paid a little less, you feel that you are cheated. It is opposite of motivation. So this job security, policies of the company, your relationship with the boss and peers, and the fringe benefits or vacations or perks, incentives, all these things, if it is not properly given, it works on the negative way. It is positive demotivation, that is negative motivation. In the same way, if you take motivation factors, they are the real motivation factors. What are they? If you are having the achievement, you are recognized for the achievement, you are given with proper responsibility in the workplace, you are given with promotions and opportunities for doing the job properly, and you have a personal growth, you are able to fulfill your own dreams, and there is an interest in the job, like you can change the job place, or you can be given with a new challenges instead of giving monotonous work. So these kind of things will give you a positive motivation. So Herzberg says that if you are giving these motivation factors, that is the first step, the people are getting motivated. You have to eliminate the hygiene factor, so it acts as the motivation factor. Are you able to understand? So he says motivation comes from both ways. Demotivation factors has to be taken care, eliminated, so that they turned to be the motivation factor. So any workplace can differentiate between the motivating and demotivating factors to make the employees more motivated. Right. The next thing.
Hygiene factors are not clear.
Hygiene factors, you want me to repeat again? Right. See, hygiene factors are the reasons when you become dissatisfied. Right. Say, for example, your peers are not working that much. You know that they take a lot of time off, but they are given with incentive and promotion because of the department. How will you feel? Demotivated, right? You are working hard, but still some others are getting more benefits. So that motivating factor for other person has become a demotivating factor for you. Right? The same way fringe benefits. If the quarters availability is that you got one quarters where water is leaking through roof, other one person is having a very good thing. So what happens? You compare and you feel that you are cheated. So these are demotivating factors. When the motivation factors acts as demotivating factors, we have to eliminate that. We have, see, usually what the theories say, look into the motivating factors, keep the people motivated. So sometimes we may not look into the demotivating factors, right? Eliminating the demotivating factors is as good as doing a motivating factor. Are you able to understand?
Madam, small clarification.
Request. Yes, yes.
The same hygiene factors could either be a motivation factors or a demotivating factors, the way it is applied, right? That's what.
Yes, exactly, exactly. Yes.
Okay, right.
So that is why you can see that we usually give the arrow mark up and down. So you can make the direction upwards anytime. right? And you should understand another one thing, that incentive or rate of pay or whatever we say as hygiene factor is demotivating for one person, not for all the people. It is motivating for some other person.
Correct.
Right? Are you able to understand? So as a HR manager, we need to look into the complexity of the hygiene factors are complex. That is why I told you, it is a positive of negative motivation. You should understand that. It is motivation only, but it at present acts as a negative. So you can change the direction to motivation. Are you able to understand?
Before this, you also discussed about one more theory, which is not in the study material. So should we study that also or how?
Yes, see, I have this question. Last time also I had this question. I'll take 5 minutes and tell you one thing. This new UGC policies and how we see MBA in the central universities now, you can see that it is as good as any regular MBA. Please remember that when you get out of the university with the MBA degree, the society and the market industry is going to look you as an MBA graduate, right? So kindly get out of this scenario that you, what is in the study material. Study material is a help given to you to basic understanding, right? As MBA graduates, I would request you to have exposure on other things also. How much you write about the real world, examples from the real world, advertisements from the TV, you use all these things from the news. This will help you get more grades, in more marks in the examination. So study material is a tool to help you understand the basics, right? So whenever possible, I am trying to put in more things, expose you to the outside world. That is my motto, purpose of this, right? So I would kindly request you to go through other books, other things also, right? Because whatever is in the study material, you cannot write it back in your examination. Clear?
Okay, ma'am.
Yes, ma'am.
Right. Yes. So be that. Because once you finish MBA, you are not finishing MBA. You are starting as an MBA. Remember that. In the outside world, you are starting the life as an MBA. So you need to know as much possible as in the management, right? Okay. So kindly study this also. When an open question comes about, write about the motivating theories. Think about your advantage, vantage point, right? Other people will write only whatever is in the study material. You will be writing one more theory. Think in the shoes of an evaluator. I am looking into the papers where the same motivating theories are there. And you are coming up with a new theory. What will you get? Obviously, more marks, right? So think out of the box. Try to learn more. Expose yourself to the real world, right? Okay, shall we go to the next one?
Yes, ma'am.
Yes, I hope all of you are working. Most of you are working?
Yes, ma'am.
Yes, ma'am.
Yes, ma'am. Then real time examples will be very easy for you, right? Okay, so this is room sale. He says about three factors again. One is expectancy. Expectancy is what you believe that if I work hard, if I am able to put in more effort, that the result will be in the my side, that I will get more positive result if I put in more effort. So that is the expectancy, right? And what is the instrumentality? That if whatever you perform, that outcome will be received. That is a reality. That is what the organization is going to do. And what is the balance? The value that you put on your effort, right? These three factors decides upon the motivation of a person. That is a scientific theory, this one. If you properly calculate the measurements, you can come out with a number, the motivational measurement, right? This is a very good theory, but little complex. Just I'll try to make it simple for you, that every person has an expectance, right? If I'm doing good, I'm working hard, I will get this much as a return. But instrumentality is what you really get outcome, right? But the value I put upon that effort is different from individual to individual. So based upon that value you add on, the motivation level also differs. Are you able to follow? Okay, I'll come up with an example. I know it is a little hard. Say, for example, I'm a married person, right? For me, time is of high value. I need to spend my time with my family, right? But still, I want to be a motivated person. So what I do, I work overtime or I stay more in the company for 2 hours every day to finish a particular target, right? So that value I put in for the 2 hours is very big, okay? And see the other person, why? He is a bachelor. He doesn't have a family to go to. He is staying in a hostel or a bachelor place. So he stays for 3 hours in the evening to complete his target. But for him, staying or hanging out in the organization, in the workplace, is more comfortable than going back to his den, right? Because he's not going to do anything there. So he is not having that much of value added to that 3 hours he put in the organization, right? So we both work like this. I put in 2 hours, he put in 3 hours every week. The next week when the performance outcome comes, we are getting incentives. Okay, you have worked so much. I am getting 3,000 rupees. He is getting 4,000 rupees. Or say 3,000, 3,000 equally as an incentive for working. Now I feel very less motivated or demotivated thinking that for this 3,000 rupees, I have spent the month's entire evening here in the organization. It is worthless, right? So next month, I may not stay and work hard. But that person may feel elated. He thinks that, okay, see, instead of going to the room, I stayed here, I'm getting 4,000 rupees. Okay, now I will stay more and I'll get more money. Are you able to see the difference? Why this happened? Because the balance of individual was entirely different. The value I put upon that time is entirely different from the value he matched to that particular time, right? So the expectancy, instrumentality and balance, these three factors act together to measure a person, individual's motivation towards his work. That is what Room's trying to tell us. Clear? Okay.
Okay,
yes,
ma'am.
Yes, right. Okay. So next one is, this is a economical theory. This one is very interesting because this is this one.
Madam, one doubt, please. Madam, one doubt. The previous slide.
Yes.
For the company say company treats the efforts from the employees regardless of their personal issues. Is it so?
Instrumentality. Yes. They give. If you perform well, valued outcome will be received. That you are rewarded with something for what you have done. Right.
As an individual, we will be feeling that the company paid less, but as the company said, they will be treating the output from the employees will be same.
Exactly.
But yes. it should be in a better understanding way that the person's actual situation, even though he is performing more, that is what to be considered, isn't it?
Yes, of course. See, so what is the ticking for us here is, I'm the boss of these two person. I'm the HR manager. Let us see like that. Okay. This X and Y. I respect both of them and I know the situation of both these people. And suddenly X stops coming from the next month for extra effort, right? So I should understand that his balance is deciding his motivating factor. So what I can do is I can make adjustments so that his value can be respected and find out some other motivating factor for him to stay back and work, right? Say for example, he wants to spend time with his family in this particular case scenario. So what I can do as a HR manager, you know, I can give a company provided vacation for 2-3 days with his family with a leave pay, right? So what will happen, you know, he will feel elated that time because his balance for that particular time is very high. Clear? So what happens? He wants to pay back to the company for that particular time he has spent with the family. That way I can motivate him.
Clear,
so
madam.
That is
clear.
How the management has to understand the employees. That's why from the beginning I'm saying again and again, every individual is different. If you are able to understand the individual, it is very easy to manage the individual. That is the work of the manager after all, right? So that is why we study all the psychological theories. Every person is unique. Every person has their own importance and values. So that is how you can evaluate a person and manage him, right?
Madam,
clear? Yes.
Madam, one small point here.
Yes.
See, in the short run, whether these things are practically possible in a company, if it is a large organization,
yes.
In the short run, whether it's possible. In the long run, maybe it's possible, but maybe we need to readjust or realign these things, let's say, in a very short span of time, this month, next month. Will it be practically possible to do this?
Yes, of course. That is why we say this delegation of authority. You need to have supervisors for a small group. So that will be escalated. See, after all, you are not going to manage 1,000 people with one supervisor. No. Maximum how many people you can have under you, better supervision can be 10 to 15. So understanding 10 to 15 person is not going to be difficult. See, we have a class of 60 students every year, say 2-3 sections. We are able to remember all the 180 people and their background, what do they speak, how do they, who are their friends. It's easy for even 1 or 2 years. So think in a long run, every manager can have that understanding. Without that, you cannot be a good manager. That is what we want to stress. Right, people has to be understood. Every people want that they should be understood, they should be heard out. A small act of hearing the grievance of a person, you need not resolve it, you need not give a solution to that. Just to hear it out, see how much motivated he is.
That is true. Yeah, that is right? Definitely possible.
Yeah, so that is possible for any supervisor, that is possible. Okay, so that's why I told you motivation is a very important topic where you can learn a lot of things of, even you can handle your superiors also. If the superior is not this much known, prone towards a HR, you can easily manage your superior if you are good in HR, you know. Okay.
Ma'am, that's a saying that 90% of an organization's work is being done by 10% of the employees.
Sorry, I didn't hear you properly. Say it again.
Ma'am, there's a saying that 90% of the work of an organization is being done by 10% of the employees.
Yes, of course. Yes, of course. You can see, if you are good in the psychology or if you are good in people's behavior, you can change the direction of thinking, you can manage them, you can make them believe something that it is possible, because many people doesn't have time. I will not say they don't know, but they don't have time to think what others think, because they are totally drowned in their own thoughts. Are you able to get the point? You don't stop and see what others are doing. Then how there is time for you to think what others are thinking? So if you give that small pause, stop and see others, observe and think what they are thinking, it would be a very smooth world actually. Right? Okay. So shall we go with the next one?
Yeah.
Yes, madam.
This is equity theory, right? See, simply I have given you a figure there. You just see that, you will understand what is equality and equity, right? Equality is giving same height of desk to all, but equity is making all stand at the same height. Clear? So what is
the slide is not visible, madam.
Yes, ma'am.
Are not able to see the slide?
No.
It's visible. It's visible for me. And please check.
Maybe you have, it will get loaded.
Yeah. Now
okay.
It's visible.
So, most of the time we do this mistake, equality. We say that we give equality to people, but it is not equity. Right? See, distributing the same amount of food to all cadres of people cannot be equality. Distributing the food according to the need of the hunger and the size and age of the person is equity. Clear? So this is what Adam's equity theory says. He says
So ma'am, our government shall switch from equality to equity.
Yes, this is a long cry for a long time that everybody is saying that. But it's very hard actually. It's a tough theory. But it is an ideal theory that we have to follow this. Equity is very important. Like in workplace also you can see that this is a problem. People are not happy with equality. Think about that small boy standing in a purple dress. Is he happy about the equality? Certainly no. Maybe he has been given with the same height. But maybe we are happy and we say that, okay, I have given the same kind of treatment to everyone. But it is not going to serve the purpose.
So the requirement should be fulfilled according to the need.
Yes, exactly. So that is what is equity theory says. The input of the job and outcome of the job cannot be equal always. So because every person's input is not equal, and so the outcome cannot be equal. So what happens? You cannot have the same treatment for both. Right. So when I see that the other person is also putting the same work and he is getting more, I will be feeling cheated, jealous. I cannot work in the same way. I may go in either way. I may put more effort or I may withdraw my effort, whichever I am giving. So both the things are possible. So this is essentially economical theory. So what do we take as motivational theory is a person's motivational needs are decided not only by his own act, but also from others' acts, right? The consequences of my colleagues, my peers, what do they get, what do they put in? All these things also act as a factor to decide on my motivating factor. Are you able to understand? This is not only the act and consequences of mine, but also the act and consequences of my peers, my subordinates, my superiors, my manager, my owner, everybody. So the input and outcome of a job decides of my motivation based on input and outcome of the jobs by other people around me in the organization. Right? Okay. So this is a very old theory, but still which can be used. Right? So with that, we finish the motivation theories. I know it's a very big chapter. I have tried to make some justification for that. So before we move on to the next topic, if you have any doubts in motivation, we can clear it now. Any doubts? No. Okay. So shall we move on to the next one?
Yes, ma'am.
Yes, madam.
Yes. So we come to the next important topic. So see, you can see again, I have made it in a flow like, we started with anxiety and we started with how people will feel about the job. Then we came to motivation. So morale leads to productivity, morale leads to motivation. And if motivation is not properly done, it leads to what? Stress. Workplace stress. You can see that there are so many words around the workplace stress. All leads to that. If you are able to read that, I can just read it out for you. The disorganization, meetings, recognition, work hours, finances, deadlines, demands, change, manager pressure, uncertainty, and what is it, work environment, targeted performance, paycheck, traffic, late hours, family, responsibility, job security. See, you can say, go on saying thousands of words, which leads to this one word, which is called as workplace stress. Stress is a very common word. It is related to the life of everyone. But we take up the particular workplace stress, okay, related to our topic. First, let me clear one thing. What is stress actually? Stress is not a harmful thing. Clarify that first, okay? Stress is a very neutral word, like attitude. We often have a mistake attitude as a negative word. Attitude is a neutral word. Attitude can be good, attitude can be bad. What is attitude? Attitude is how your actions is oriented. That is attitude. Same way, stress is outcome of all these things. Your attitude, behavior, your work, your way of working, all these things. Stress is a very neutral word. It is not good nor bad. It's a normal word. But you can say there are three kinds of stress. Eustress, new stress, distress. As I told you, this eustress is the good stress, euphoria stress we call it as. Good stress, what is that? Say for example, you are competing in a singing competition, right? You are very good, but with a small 2 points, you got second and another one person got first. Now in the second round, you want to compete more properly. You are euphoriated. You are having a stress that I should win. That is eustress, right? Your stress is pushing you forward. It is making you happy. I think you are in the first place. You want to hold that first place. You are feeling a stress. That is good stress, right? New stress is neutral. Say for example, in the same singing competition, you have taken the third or fourth place. You are feeling a small stress. you don't know whether you will win or you are going to go back. Either way, you are not going to feel much happy or sad. Right? Already you are in fourth place. If you win, you are happy. If you are going to lose also, you are not going to feel bad. So that is new stress. You are feeling stressed for the second round, but not significantly stressed as new stress or distress. Right? Distress is a bad stress. You are in the, say for example, third, and you have only 2 points to go to second or first place. You are distressed. You have to fight two people. You cannot go back. You feel bad stress, negative stress. Right? So this distress is what we often take as a meaning for stress. Right? What we often talk about stress is distress. What we mean is distress. Right? So remember that stress is good. Without stress, you cannot work. Stress is a form of motivation. Stress is a form of anxiety. Stress is what? See, literally what is stress? If you are pushing something, stressing, that is stress. If you leave it, what happens? It jumps out, right? So stress is what, like in a running competition, you can see that there is a small pyramid kept near the shoe of a person. So he can stress that block and push forward, right? So stress is must for a race. You are running, you need a stress. So stress is good. Only distress is bad. You need stress. So what are these bad stress in your workplace? How will you get? You can have 4 kinds of stress in your workplace. First one is anticipatory stress, which is you imagine things. You are anticipating, okay, this is going to happen. Now I may get a promotion, or I may not get a transfer promotion. Somebody else is going to get. You are anticipating things, and that is why you are getting the stress, right? The second one is time stress. You are given with a target. You are not able to finish on time. You are running in a race with the time. This is a very common stress many of us feel. Like say for example, now it is 1:05. I have 10 more minutes. But in my mind, I am calculating how many topics I can finish off. It is creating a timely stress for me, right? This is unavoidable. Many of us go through this one. The third one is situational stress. The particular situation, say for example, you are having an argument with your peers, and suddenly you got a burst of anger, you have thrown something and your monitor is broken. You don't know what is the action is going to be from the management. This is situational stress. At that night, before the inquiry, you cannot sleep. You are developing stress, right? Encounter stress. This is because somebody is targeting you or somebody is fighting with you. You have to encounter your situation. Can be a person, it can be an organization, it can be anything. So you have to encounter that. When this situation arises, this is called as encounter stress. So these are the normally, usually, which the workplace can create stress to you. There are so many other stress also. Just I have given you the broad categories of stress. Now, what are the symptoms of stress? I have given you some, but you can write 1,000 symptoms. Stress can have a unique way of evolving in every person. You can make a new way of symptom for a stress, because everybody has their own way of reacting. So stress can be giving you symptoms in various ways. Just the normal, usual stress symptoms I have listed out, you can read it out. Depression, anxiety, anger, irritability, restlessness, feeling overwhelmed or unmotivated or unfocused, not able to sleep, and continuously thinking some things, or you are worried, you are not able to think properly. We call it as fatigue or fogged memory. And the memory and the concentration becomes a problem. You are not able to decide consciously. You are not able to properly decide as usual. If you are a bad decider, always no problem. But suddenly you are not able to decide properly. So all these things are symptoms of stress, which are emotional. Right? So apart from this, you may feel a lot of other things, like you are not able to eat, or you are not able to love the person as usual, what you are usually doing. Like this, what is this? I'll make it bigger. So, see, what is that? It says that it's a small joke to understand. They are teaching work-life balance, and they say that we have more work. That is the way we can balance the life. So, see, these are smaller things that the organizations do, and we keep on building up the stress. And how to manage the stress? You have to understand stressors. As this is also an important topic, I would like to take time in managing stress, because you know stress, What are the symptoms of stress? Let us know how you can manage stress. Beyond the learning of this and passing through of the HRM, this will give you a life lesson. Okay, so understand this properly. First, understand the stressor, where you are getting the stress from. Stressors are the point of stress, where it provokes, where it starts, right? Track the stressors. When you start stressing out and who or what is causing that. If you are able to do that, half of your problem is solved, right? You can just go away from the stressor or you can eliminate the stressor. Both ways you can manage. And developing healthy responses. Say, for example, some situation, timely, time stress. Very simple. If you have a proper time management schedule and a discipline to follow the time management, the time stress can be totally eliminated. Right? You would have seen that from today's starting of the class, I have taken a minimal time for each slide to go on with my plan so that at the end of the class, I need not worry about whether I'll be able to finish. So that stress can be avoided. Right? And establishing boundaries. I should know how much I can allow other person. This is not about physical boundary. You know, this is about a emotional, mental boundary. You have a mind space exactly like your home space. Will you allow anybody to enter into your home? You keep a lot of locks in your home. A main door, a grill door. You lock it with that. You keep the key safe. All these things you do for the physical space you are living in. How many of us know the boundaries of our mental space, mind space, and how many of us are efficient enough to keep other people's away from entering into your mind space? No. It is like an open garbage bin. Anybody can put anything into your mind space. You never stop that. You don't know how to say no to some people who are spoiling you, who are corrupting you, who are poisoning you. See, for example, first thing is the newspaper. How many negative news you read every day? How many dirty things you allow to enter into your mind space? We never bother about that, right? You don't have the boundary for that. When you are locking up your home, you should have the same precaution for your mind space also. You cannot allow everybody to put their own ideas, their own garbages into your home. Will you do that? But you are allowing it to your mind space, right? It's a very important point. Now, establish boundaries. Don't allow through TV or newspaper or through person to put in wrong ideas or unwanted things into your mind space, right? Another one is relaxing techniques. Say, for example, if you are reading newspaper, you need relaxation. You know, you are reading about 10, 15 news of some evil things happening in the country. I'm not saying that you should not read the newspaper, but you should be able to understand the boundary of your mind space. And you should understand how much that news is acting as a stressor to you. If it really is stressing you, then you should be able to manage that. How? You can relax. You can think about some positive things or you can eliminate that stressor. And communicating with superiors in the workplace is the next one. If you are feeling stressed out, if you are able to not avoid the stressors, talk to the superiors. Try to manage that. And if you are not able to do it by yourself, there is nothing wrong in getting some support. Seek some counselors. It can be available in the organization itself, or the counselor or mentor can be your own friends or from the seniors. Somewhere, find out someone from your relations. Find someone, maybe sometimes your spouse can be your support, you know. But many times we are not allowing our ego to talk to the spouse more openly, because spouse can be a very good companion, but our ego will not allow that because we are seeking support. So they may think us as a weaker person. We don't want that. We want to show to the spouse as a stronger one. So support can be from anywhere. Even I would say support can be from the children. It is not wrong, nothing wrong in that. Say, for example, I seek support from my son often. There is nothing wrong. If I'm feeling confused or I want my mind space to be clear, sharing with my son and getting his ideas or support is not at all wrong. So this is how you can manage stress. From the other side, this is from your internal side. How can you manage stress from the other side, organizational side? See, as a manager, if you find your employee is stressed out, what you can do? You can provide job responsibilities, make him understand that. So this is your job. You need not worry out of scope. then you can have manageable work shifts. Like, see, for example, some person may have an ailment, father or mother in hospital, so he is not able to run to hospital and organization during the daytime. Give him shifts. So organizational support can be given to eliminate many of the stressors by just small adjustments can be made. And breaks between exhaustive work. If it is a continuous and exhaustive work, need not be physical, it can be mental also. If you are having exhaustive work, the organization can have breaks in between so that a small break can go a long way, right? Then job rotation. So if there is high stress and low stress jobs, you can make the people move from one place to other. Often organizations fail to do this, you know, because we say that high stress job profilers are like donkeys. They will do hard work. So what the organization want to do, they will keep on that person go with the high stress job. And there will be some coat loaders who will not do properly the job. So they will be in the low stress job. And the organization is afraid to put this person in the high stress job so that he may not do the work properly. But this is not a right way. You should make the job rotation to high stress and low stress job so that the people can breathe in between. And you can give proper training and support to manage stress. And a workplace which is happy, healthy and harmonious. Harmonious workplace is where you can synchronize with other people. You can rely upon, you can have like a band. So that is harmonious workplace. That will go a long way in stress management. And providing job security and having the alignment of career growth of the individuals along with the opportunities of the organization. This will help managing the stress from organizational side. So this is a nutshell of stress management. Okay. I think we are running out of time. If you are willing to stay for another 5 minutes, shall we see another one topic?
Sure.
Okay, right. Thank you. And any doubts in this one? Stress, do you have any topics?
No, no, madam. It is clear.
Very good. Okay, I forgot to add one more slide on stress. Actually, I have given you the symptoms of emotional stress here. But add to this a lot of physical symptoms. After emotional symptoms, what happens, you know, you will start having physical symptoms also. Why this happens? The stress starts with a mental problem. But during that, what happens? Your body also responds to that stress. Adrenaline starts working and the gland produces some hormones. If you are often having stress, what happens? These will settle in the places where you will feel pain, or you will see, sometimes you will feel eye pain, headache, you may again, once again, you can say thousands of physical symptoms of stress. All these are unique to every person. You cannot say everybody will have headache. Many of us even can have stomachache, which is not at all relevant to stress, right? But you don't know. Physical symptoms also arises out of stress, which is the exact symptom of distress. Distress tends to leave you with physical harm. Remember that. Unless you manage stress properly, you will be bound to happen to have some pain. And that time, it will become too late to rectify it. So, identify the stress at the early stage and try to avoid any physical harm that happens to your body. Right? Because stress is really a very bad, distress is a very bad symptom. Because often it leads to hypertension, which leads to blood pressure, and which leads to a lot of complications in your body, right? So try to manage stress properly, right? We come to the next topic, quality of work life. I just told you about what is that in the previous chapter, but stress leads to this, you know, when we talk about stress and managing of stress, QWL is a very important way of managing the stress in a workplace. Quality of work life. Let us understand what is your work life. I think I told you that day. We spend our prime time of prime life in the organization, right? Say from 22 to 60, that is my vital lifetime. And during that time also, I spend my prime time in the organization. So it is like I am sacrificing my life, prime life, to the organization for some other's dream. Somebody else is running an organization to fulfill that dream. And I am sacrificing myself to fulfill that dream. So this is how the reality hits me. So I am not doing myself anything for myself, right? But why I am working, I am saying to myself, I am working to lead my life better. See how paradoxical it is. I am not living in my life, whereas I am thinking that I am working for my life. So this is where this QWL comes, right? The work life is a major life for you. You are spending more time in the office, in the organization. So that life, which is the, we call as work life, should be qualitative to make you lead a quality-oriented life. Is it clear? So that is why this quality of work life has become a very important topic in recent HR. Right? So what is that can be defined as? It is a quality of the person's life in an organization. See, how you are able to keep your identity, individuality, and your satisfying factor of life in the organization, the experiences, collective experiences in the organization, decides the quality of your work life. Every day, this is happening every day. Like, see, if you calculate the entire amount you spend in your organization, then you will understand the magnanimity of the life you spend in the organization and why it should be qualitative, right? Right. How you can make the work life qualitative? I have given you a small picture of an organization. It's a Japanese organization. It's an office. It's not a park, right? Can you see how the quality of work life will be here?
It's funny.
Yeah, simply, right? So this is how you can increase the quality of work life. You need not go to a park. See, the environment will be very happy here. So it starts with fair compensation. See, after all, we go to work for one thing first. What is it? Money, right? So a fair compensation will keep your work life qualitative. And a safe and healthy working condition so that you can develop your human capacities in the organization, career growth, social integration. Workforce should be equity oriented, and work organization constitution should be equal to everyone. Work and quality of life, special relevance to work. So these points contributes to the quality of work life, right? Your work and life constitutes of work life. And that should be qualitative. That is what this quality of work life leads to. And we call this as balancing of work and life also. You should balance properly. Like, see, for example, nowadays you can see this young mothers can have their babies at the workplace with a crush attached to it, and the time given for them to feed their baby at the workplace. This will contribute to the quality of the work life. And there is one more thing which is not in your book, I think, study material, but I would like to note down. It is called as spirituality in the workplace, like quality of workplace. Spirituality is workplace is also a unique topic which is evaluated in India actually, because we need not study that properly. You can see in India, every workplace will have a worship, place of worship also, a small place of worship. Every weekend or sometimes they will go do a puja in any shop you can see, which is not present in many of the European world. So this spirituality in workplace has become an important topic in European and US countries. They see this as a new development, which we are used to. We live with that. But Europeans and US is now looking into this particular concept as spirituality in workplace. What do they say? The workplace, when many people feel spiritual, that elevates the quality of the workplace. Workplace can be made harmonious through spirituality. That is spirituality of workplace, right? So that is also another one topic related to QWL, quality of work life. So with that, we finish off this particular topic also. If you have any queries, we can see that now. Do you have any queries? I'll see in the chat box. You can type in the chat box, please, if you have any queries.
No, ma'am, it's all clear.
Yeah, very good. Okay. So, myself, hierarchy theory of motivation. Okay, there is one. Adira has asked one thing. I've critically examined the need hierarchy theory of motivation. This is a part B question. Yes, this need hierarchy theory of motivation is what we have seen. Maslow's theory, Abraham Maslow's theory. And that is... what you have to do is critically examine. So first you have to explain the theory, then you have to see the exceptions. What are the exceptions? What are the generalizations? And what are the critical points which are opposite, which you cannot able to justify with the theory? These three things you can write for part B. apart from explaining the theory. First, you have to explain the theory, right? Second one, you have to critically examine. Three things you can do: generalizations, exceptions, criticality, right? Okay. Then Sudeep has asked one thing: spirituality in workplace. Yes, exactly. Spirituality in workplace is where you can imbibe the spirituality among people inside the workplace. See, it is not religiousness. Understand the difference. We are not talking about religion in the workplace. It is about spirituality. You can see that you are elevated in your spiritualness. So the harmony of the workplace will be good. That is what they mean, right? You can belong to various religions, various castes. It is not about caste, community or religion. It's only about the feeling of spirituality in the workplace, right? Anything else? Okay. Ma'am, what about the stages of reaction to stressors? Very good. Ramya has asked one question. Stages of reaction. Say, for example, first I told you emotional symptoms. You may feel angry, irritation. That is your first stage. Then you may feel anxiety. You will be rushing to do something. Third one, you will start feeling physical symptoms, like you will not feeling to eat properly. You will not be able to sleep properly. This is a starting of physical symptom. Then what happens? You will feel irritation in your eye. You will be having headache. That is your next physical symptom. Slowly, this becomes permanent. Then you can see that you are feeling BP or your eyes become red. You will feel pain. All these things come. So these are the stages of reaction. So if you are not eliminating stressor at the starting, this will go to further elongated critical points in your body, right? And also the mental harm also. It is not only physical. You will feel mentally harmed because of stress, right? Okay. I think with that, we can conclude the session.
Yes, ma'am.
Thank you very much for being wonderful students. Okay. Thank you very much.
Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you, ma'am. Thank you.
Yes, ma'am. Thank you. Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you, ma'am.
So our next session, someone could kindly tell on the next session.
First lunch break, sir.
Yeah, I understand. And by 2 o'clock we will rejoin, right?
Yeah.
Okay.
Maybe thank you. Again, HR manager. Yesterday they have sent that timetable, no, Atish.
2 o'clock.
Operation management.
See the schedule. 2 o'clock
financial management. Chandrasekhar sir.
Fourth hour. Dr. R. Venkatesh Kumar, Operation and Research Management, and fifth hour, Finance Management.
Okay. Thank you.
2 to 3, 3 to 4.
Ramprasad sir, can I ask you something? I think all of the participants are right now fourth sum or third sum. Like all of it's a mixture.
Second sum. No?
Second, oh, you're on the second sum.
Yeah, correct.
Yeah, this is second sum subjects only.
Yeah, I understand. See, that I understand. This is second sum subject, but I think there may be participants from third or fourth sum also, because many people haven't attended the exams. Even the classes. See, right now, I am in third semester. I wouldn't be able to attend any PCP classes.
Yeah.
Now only I could be able to attend the second semester classes. That's why I'm asking.
Okay, what is the doubt?
My doubt is that, Mr. Ramkumar, are you right now in second semester?
Yeah, I am in second semester.
Okay. I think most of the participants are in second semester. Myself, I am in right now in third semester. I told you that I couldn't be.
Okay, if you are in the third semester and if you have some incompletes, absent for the exam in the second semester, you can write second semester as well as third semester exams
in a single stretch. Okay,
no problem.
Okay, fine.
If you can prepare for all the subjects second semester and third semester, you can write, you can complete that.
Okay,
but the problem is when is our exam schedule? That we don't know.
Nobody knows. Yeah,
and exams also should not clash. No, second sem, third sem,
no, no. Sir Prasad sir,
huh?
They will take care of that because they will be aware that
many people would not have either taken the exam.
Some students who are in the third semester, they will also be having the obligation to write the second semester exams.
I will not attend even a single exam right now.
In my opinion, they will ensure that there is no clash or coincidence of the second or third semester exams.
Let's hope so.
Yeah.
In my opinion.
Ram Prasad sir, can I ask you one thing? Like, at the same time, is there any other PCP classes going on, like for third sem or for some like that?
I am not aware of that.
We won't know that.
Usually, yeah, it is going on because usually whenever you are receiving that WhatsApp message, in that maybe we are fine timetable for the sometimes third sem, fourth sem like that. We have to ask that coordinator.
But Ram Prasad, they would have done different WhatsApp groups for each of these semesters. No, so they will be posting in those groups. If at all,
because when we enrolled for the exams in 2019, so they have formed a group based on the 2019.
Ram Prasad sir, actually there is, as of now, there is 4 or 5 groups with the same heading, like MBA marketing Pondicherry University. We don't know which group is genuine, or all the groups are genuine. Anyway, we are taking.
Don't know, sir, because if you have enrolled for this DDE exams in 2018, then you have to ask the coordinator, ensure that your number is added in that group so that you will get the information for the third semester as well.
Are you sure that the EDD authorities have formed any groups or any, are they into this coordination of, students can do different?
No, actually they have, made separate groups. This group is only for second semester. Only a second semester.
Unita madam.
Yeah, please, just I was hearing what you people are speaking on. Can I intervene and tell you some few things that these groups which you are having, WhatsApp groups, are created by us. Okay, we have created these groups. You are right in one thing. We have created according to the year wise, like 2019 is for all of you in second semester, and you are grouped as per the specialization. Even though you are in second semester, HRM specialization people will be under HRM groups and marketing will be under marketing groups for the convenience of third and fourth semester. Okay, and why there are so many groups is WhatsApp groups has some limits. So as the number of students are high, we have 4 or 5 groups according to the number of enrollment.
Okay, ma'am.
They are designated groups, but see to that we are in that group. So WhatsApp groups will not go more than that. So kindly ensure that this is the official group. What you are saying is an official group. And for another question, third and fourth semester classes have not yet started, so don't worry. We will be informing you when third and fourth semester classes start. For all clarifications, easy way is to kindly go through the website DDE portal often. Say for example, weekly once at least. You will see some notifications in that. If you still have any doubts, you can send mails to the coordinator or director or to the concerned faculty. So we will be very happy to inform you the clarify the doubts. Right?
Thank you.
That is another one way. We regularly see the mails and we regularly respond to the mails, right?
Madam, exam schedule, madam.
Yeah, that's actually we have told already, you have to wait for some more time. The authorities are deciding upon that. There is a lot of difficulties during this pandemic because you are spread all over India. It's not like regular class. So we have to look upon a lot of infrastructural facilities, first of all. So that is why it is taking time. Kindly be patient and wait. The university will look into all the problems and it will sort it out. It is going on. I assure you that. It is going on.
Tentatively, madam. Tentatively.
Yes, tentatively. December.
December. Yes, for the undabba. Madam, ni maatrandi. Tentatively, approximately.
It will be around December, hopefully. Okay,
after
so
Christmas,
we have to wait.
Madam.
Yeah, after Christmas, maybe.
Ma'am, could you make online facility for remitting the examination fee?
That's what, see, all these things you will receive notifications, no need to worry. Kindly look into the university website every week. Or else you can, personal queries like this, you can send to the mail IDs, right? So, just for, because of this pandemic, I would tell you that be patient for some more time. Certainly, you will have your queries answered. Don't worry. Okay?
Ma'am, it is announced to pay examination fee. Could you make it online facility for paying the examination fees?
No, so, we cannot come. See, I don't know what is happening on that side. So, you need to wait and see. Maybe they will, hopefully they will do that too. Because now, because of this pandemic situation, everybody is looking for online payments only. So, that would also be done, hopefully, right? So, we have to wait and see. That takes some time.
Madam, for attending exams, we may need some initial advance information to office also. That is why we will get enough time for information to get notification.
At least 10 days, madam. Yeah, you will have enough time. Don't worry. Okay,
because
madam.
We have to
just
inform to
the examinations. You just prepare for the examinations well. That would be the best way to handle the situation now. Okay?
Thank you, ma'am.
So now I take leave, okay? Thank you. We'll see tomorrow. Bye-bye.
Hello, madam.
Thank you.
Madam.
Thank you, madam.
Yes.
Madam, when to pay the exam fees?
You will get the notification. That's what I'm saying. Please wait. You will get clear notifications for all these things. Right?
Okay. Thank
just
you, madam.
Be patient and wait. Thank you. Bye-bye.
Thank you, madam. Thank you.
Ramprasad sir.
Yeah, tell me.
December last day, first semester and second semester exam.
First semester?
And second semester exam, December.
No.
Yeah, tell me.
They are saying, so we are not sure and when is the exam scheduled? And university is looking at all the pros and cons. So, tentatively, they are saying that after December, our exams may be scheduled. And suppose the December 26 exam, maybe by December 16, December 10, they will intimate us prior. Like that they are saying.
Rasaini. Ramprasad sir, I had two papers for semester back.
Okay. Prepare for that subject also.
When? And we'll do that. December month exam.
Exam schedule is not yet given, no.
December second semester and fourth semester exam.
Examination schedule not given. December post Christmas, exam schedule will be out. In that exam schedule, you will have the schedule for first semester, second semester, third semester, fourth semester as well.
Okay, okay.
Then you please check out and you pay the fee.
PCP classes, first semester and second semester classes, PCP classes.
Now.
Hello?
Yeah, now it is first and second semester going on.
Going. Then December first semester and second semester exam. Is it correct?
What?
ചങ്ങായി മാഷ എന്നാരാ പറഞ്ഞേ
മനസ്സിലായോ
രാം പ്രസാദ് സാർ
ആ ബത്തായി
ആ രാം മലയാളം
ബത്തായി
ഓൺലി വൺ വേർഡ് മനസ്സിലായോ
മനസ്സിലായി
മലയാളീസ് ഉണ്ടോ മലയാളികൾ ആരാ ഉള്ളത് സംസാരിച്ചോ ഐ എം രതീഷ് ഫ്രം കൊച്ചിൻ
മലയാളീസ് ഉണ്ട്
പറഞ്ഞോ പറഞ്ഞോ എന്താ പ്രശ്നം
പ്രശ്നം എന്ന് വെച്ചാല് രണ്ട് പേപ്പർ ഫസ്റ്റ് സെമസ്റ്ററിൽ കിട്ടാനുണ്ട് അപ്പൊ അത് ഇപ്പോ ഡിസംബറിൽ എഴുതാൻ പറ്റുമോ
ഇതിപ്പം മാഡം പറഞ്ഞത് പുനീത മാഡം പറഞ്ഞത് ഈ എക്സാംസിന്റെ കാര്യത്തില് പ്രത്യേകിച്ച് ഒരു തീരുമാനം ഇതുവരെ യൂണിവേഴ്സിറ്റിയുടെ ഭാഗത്ത് ഉണ്ടായിട്ടില്ല കാരണം ഈ പാൻഡമിക് ഇങ്ങനെ നിൽക്കുന്നത് കൊണ്ട് അവര് കൂടി ആലോചിക്കുന്നേ ഉള്ളൂ അപ്പം നമ്മളെന്തായാലും എക്സാമിന് ഒരു 10-15 ദിവസം മുമ്പ് അവരെ ഇന്റിമേറ്റ് ചെയ്യും അങ്ങനെ ഇന്റിമേറ്റ് ചെയ്യുമ്പോൾ അവർ ഫിക്സ് ചെയ്യുന്ന എക്സാംസ് ഫസ്റ്റ് സെമം സെക്കൻഡ് സെമം തേർഡ് സെമം ഫോർത്ത് സെമം ഒക്കെ എക്സാംസ് ഉണ്ടാകും അതിന്റെ ടെൻറ്റേറ്റീവ് ഡേറ്റുകൾ അവർ നമ്മളെ അറിയിക്കും ഈ പറയുന്ന 10-15 ദിവസങ്ങൾക്ക് മുമ്പ് അതുകൊണ്ട് ടെൻഷന്റെ ആവശ്യം ഒന്നും ഇല്ലെന്നാണ് മാഡം പറഞ്ഞത് ഇപ്പം
സാർ
ഫൗദ് സാറിന് ഫസ്റ്റ് ഇയറിൽ രണ്ട്
പേർ വേണ്ട ടെൻഷൻ വേണ്ട
അതെ അതെ അപ്പം ഇത് ഫോർ എക്സാമ്പിൾ ഞാൻ എനിക്ക് എന്റെ ജോലിയുടെ ഇതുകൊണ്ട് എനിക്ക് ഇതുവരെ ഒരു എക്സാം പോലും എഴുതാൻ പറ്റിയിട്ടില്ല ഞാനിപ്പോ ശരിക്കും എനിക്ക് 4 സെമസ്റ്ററിന്റെ ബുക്സും കിട്ടി ആസ് ഓഫ് നൗ ഞാൻ ഇപ്പൊ തേർഡ് സെമ്മിലാണ് അപ്പം ഡോണ്ട് വറി അബൌട്ട് എല്ലാ സ്റ്റേജിലുള്ള ആളുകളും നമ്മുടെ ഗ്രൂപ്പിലുണ്ട് ഒരു എക്സാം എഴുതാത്തവരുണ്ട് ഫസ്റ്റ് സെം എഴുതിയവരുണ്ട് ക്ലിയർ ചെയ്തവരുണ്ട് സെക്കൻഡ് എഴുതിയവരുണ്ട് അങ്ങനെയുള്ള പല ടൈപ്പ് ഓഫ് ആളുകളുണ്ട് സോ ദാറ്റ് വി ക്യാൻ ഷെയർ അവർ കൺസേൺസ് ഓർ അവർ എന്താ നമ്മുടെ മനസ്സിലുള്ള കാര്യങ്ങൾ ഷെയർ ചെയ്യാം സോ ദാറ്റ് വി വിൽ റെഡ്യൂസ് ദ സ്ട്രെസ് മോർ ഓർ ലെസ് അതാണ് ഏറ്റവും ഇമ്പോർട്ടൻറ്റ് സോ ഡോണ്ട് വറി സ്ട്രെസ് ഒന്നും വേണ്ട എല്ലാ സപ്പോർട്ടും ഉണ്ടെന്ന് മാം ഇപ്പം പറഞ്ഞിട്ടുണ്ട് നമുക്ക് എന്ത്
അല്ല ഇപ്പോ ക്ലാസ് സ്റ്റാർട്ട് ചെയ്തത് ഫസ്റ്റ് സെമസ്റ്ററും സെക്കൻഡ് സെമസ്റ്ററും അല്ലേ